Hi, everyone. I want to start off by welcoming you to Beyond 1619 Part 1. I'm so excited that you're here. This portion of the seminar will be recorded, so we'll be using the chat.
Let's do this. Let's do chat.
All right. So here's a bit about me. My name's Amanda, and I'm a student at W.T. Woodson High School, a Fairfax County high school, and I'm also the current editor-in-chief of the Woodson newspaper, The Cavalcade. Lydia will be my chat person for today, and Ms. Edwards will be in the background handling any tech issues. Now, I'm sure you're wondering why I'm doing this, and well, there are a few reasons. One, there's a lot going on in the world and it's hard to digest everything. I'm lucky enough to have a group of people that I can talk to, but I know everyone doesn't. Two, I wanted to take my passion for journalism and combine it with current issues in our world. And lastly, when I began the journey of creating Beyond 1619, John Lewis was still alive and he's now no longer with us. The world is changing rapidly and it's getting harder and harder to keep up. So these points combined led me to create Beyond 1619. I want to thank you all for choosing to attend the seminar, and now I'm going to go over today's schedule. First, I'm going to go over the objectives of the seminar, then the purpose of day one. Then we'll go over some American history and current events. After, I'll introduce today's guest speaker and we'll have a guided discussion. And finally, we'll finish off by talking about what's next. The chat will be open, so feel free to share your thoughts throughout the seminar. All right, so there are three main goals for this seminar. One, to create a place where we can talk about racism and equity issues. Two, to discuss how we can use social media in a way that won't impact us negatively. And three, to brainstorm how we can take action. While social media is one way to advocate, there are other things we can do. And today we're going to be focusing on that first point, talking about discrimination, racism, and equity issues in Fairfax County, plus in our larger communities. So let's do a quick poll. How many of you have used Zoom before? Scan the QR code or use the link in the chat to see the poll. So we'll take a few minutes to do that. All right. So we're going to close the poll off now and see the results. Can we go back to the results? All right, so it looks like a lot of people are familiar with Zoom, so we're gonna skip the features. All right, next poll. In one word, describe how you feel when engaging in conversations about race. And once again, scan the QR code or use the link in the chat. Right. Let's wait a few more seconds to give everyone a chance to put their thoughts in. All right, we're now going to close the poll and then see the results. All right, people are feeling nervous, all right. Empowered, open-minded, curious, all right, great. So now let's move on. Before we start, a quick disclaimer. Some of the content in this presentation might be upsetting and/or triggering. So now we're going to go over some history and current events, but first I want to define some common terms that will be used throughout this presentation. Equality versus equity. What's the difference? Equality is where you give the exact same thing to everyone, where equity is where you give based on need. Discrimination is where you treat someone differently based on certain aspects such as race. Lynching is an illegal planned killing. Prejudice is an opinion formed without any solid reasoning. And racism is discrimination or prejudice against an individual or group based on race. All right. Now that we've gone over some terms, I want to quickly explain the name of this seminar. Beyond 1619 is inspired by the 1619 Project, which was created by Nicole Hannah Jones, who's a journalist for the New York Times. If you know anything about this project, share your thoughts in the chat. Lydia will read out some of your comments.
Okay, so we have some comments in the chat. I believe 1619 was a project made to tell African American history how it was rather than giving the sugar-coated version.
Thank you for sharing, everyone.
Most powerful action, I am on board, was one more comment.
Thank you for sharing. The 1619 Project is an initiative that reflects on the legacy of slavery in the United States. It starts in August of 1619, when the first group of slaves arrived in Point Comfort, which is now modern day Fort Monroe in Hampton, Virginia. So this project was created in August of 2019, which marks the 400th year anniversary of the start of slavery. The project maps out the history of slavery from 1619 to current day racial issues. The 1619 Project inspired me to create Beyond 1619 because through it, I learned a lot about this area's history and its impact on our community today. Okay, we're gonna do another poll. Since you've been in FCPS, have you had a teacher of color? Scan the QR code or use the link in the chat. Okay, we're gonna wait a few more seconds before closing the poll out.
So we have some comments in the chat regarding the poll. Have you ever had a person of color and teacher in FCPS? So my kids have really good ones too. And then someone else said yes.
We're now going to close the poll off and see the final results. All right, looks like we got a mixed bunch. So some people, okay. So everyone's had at least one teacher of color. So Let's go back. All right. So here are some hiring statistics. Here are some staff hiring statistics by race in Fairfax County. In the 2018-19 school year, around 75% hired were white, 8.3% were black, 6.8% were Asian, 6% were Hispanic, and the other 4% were mixed. At the NAACP meeting held last week with Superintendent Brabrand, it was stated that 26 out of 222 schools in our county don't have any teachers of color. These hiring patterns contribute to the racial injustices we face every day in schools. How are we supposed to feel understood by our teachers and staff if we can't relate to them? We'll talk more about what we can do on Wednesday. So now we're going to look at something a bit bigger, high school names. I'm sure that many of you have heard about Lee High School being renamed to John Lewis High School. And Jeb Stuart High School being renamed to Justice High School. But how much do you know about who these schools were originally named after? Feel free to type in the chat. Lydia will read out the comments.
That's very disappointing. I don't see FCPS doing anything to fix this. This is a helpful visual. Jeb Stuart was a Confederate military officer. There was an incident at a football game where a student brought a poster comparing both the Confederates. None of the students responsible faced any repercussions. Not much. I know they were either slave owners or Confederate officers. Robert E. Lee was a Confederate soldier, meaning he fought for keeping slavery in the States. Now is a time to not only ask the questions, but take action together. Ready to move on, Amanda.
Great. Thank you, Lydia, and thank you everyone for sharing. We'll dive deeper in the following slides. All right, we're going to start with Robert E. Lee. Lee was a top Confederate general during the Civil War. In a letter to his wife from 1856, found by historians, Lee says, "Slavery is a moral and political evil." He continues on to say that slaves need to be disciplined. These statements contradict each other and highlight the complexity of slavery. But how does this reflect on our county? Feel free to comment in the chat.
FCPS also contradicts themselves because although they have changed the school names, they do not uphold this legacy. Racism is still present in the classrooms, sports, and extracurriculars. Although Robert E. Lee was a Virginian, it does not mean we should praise him and name a school after him because he represents the fight to keep slavery. We can make this right without our steps going back. We always know what we don't know. Mistakes will happen, but one if we do something. We can move on, Amanda.
Thank you everyone for sharing. Jeb Stuart is best known as a U.S. Army officer who later became Major General and Cavalry Commander for the Confederacy during the Civil War. Stuart also served under Lee for a period of time. And in both instances, these high schools were originally named after Confederate soldiers, which brings light to racial issues in Fairfax County alone. Another example would be my own high school, Wilbur Tucker Woodson High School. So who was Wilbur Tucker Woodson? When Woodson High School opened in 1962, the school was named after Superintendent Wilbur Tucker Woodson, who was in favor of keeping Fairfax County Public Schools desegregated. FCPS didn't fully integrate until 1971, 17 years after the Supreme Court decision Brown versus Board of Education, which called for the integration of U.S. schools. Although plans for integrating were presented in August of 1959, FCPS would take another decade to fully implement these plans. The last high school I'll be mentioning is TJ, Thomas Jefferson High School. Now, I want to start off by saying that I'm not claiming Jefferson's good or bad. The same goes for all the other people I have mentioned. Humans are flawed and no one is perfect. There's a lot that Jefferson did that helped shape this country. But today, we're going to be focusing on what naming a school after him means for today's society. Jefferson created the Declaration of Independence. We've all heard the famous line, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal." But who does that really include? Feel free to share your thoughts in the chat.
Rich white men, white wealthy men, white males, white wealthy men. Changing these names are very controversial processes when it is only the first step in combating racism in FCPS. When he wrote it, landowners. We also have a comment from one of the previous slides that perpetuates the ideology of racism towards the students arriving in the school. Having Confederate soldiers as high school names gives a false impression for students who are not educated on the true actions and behaviors the famous figures follow. It should include everyone, black and white people. There should have been no slavery. Agreed. We can move on now, Emanda.
All right. Thank you, Lydia, and thank you everyone for sharing. Jefferson's "all men are created equal" does not apply to everyone here. It was for white, wealthy, landowning men. Lastly, Thomas Jefferson was a slave owner. In fact, when he was writing one of his most well-known works, his brother-in-law, a slave, was in the room working for him. Photographed here is Thomas Jefferson and his great-grandson, Shannon Lanier. To quote Lanier, "Jefferson was a brilliant man who preached equality, but he didn't practice it." Lanier is a descendant of Sally Hemings, who was one of Jefferson's slaves. She had 7 children. At the age 16, Sally agreed to return to Monticello and leave Paris where she was free, as long as she got privileges. She was also able to negotiate for her children's freedom. Now, it's no surprise Jefferson had an immense impact on this country, but should we have a school named after him? Feel free to share your thoughts in the chat.
Nope, I don't agree. No, because he symbolizes hypocrisy and white male superiority. Was he exempt from his wrongs because he was a founding father? We have a school named after him that has no black students. Quite disappointing. But are we going to erase him from history? I don't agree that he should have owned slaves, and he clearly should have practiced what he preached. There are black students at TJ. I think it's one thing to appreciate what Jefferson did for this country at his foundation, but his morals represent something that don't represent America today, so no. If it's done with all information, I can say the founding fathers are flawed. We can teach lessons with the names of schools intact. There were no Black students registered to attend the class this year at TJ. I don't believe that not naming these schools after men like Jefferson erases history. Teach the lessons, but change the names. Agreed. So now we can close the chat. Back to you, Amanda.
Thank you. Thank you everyone for sharing, and we'll dive deeper during our discussion. Now, let's watch this poem written by Dr. Smith.
Letter to five of the presidents who owned slaves while they were in office. George Washington, when you won the revolution, how many of your soldiers did you send from the battlefield to the cotton field? How many had to trade in their rifles for plows? Can you blame the slaves who ran away to fight for the British because at least the redcoats were honest about their oppression? Thomas Jefferson, when you told Sally Hemings that you would free her children if she remained your mistress, did you think there was honor in your ultimatum? Did you think we wouldn't be able to recognize the assault in your signature that's raping your slave when you disguise it as bribery, make it less of a crime? When you wrote the Declaration of Independence, did you ever intend for Black people to have freedom over their bodies? James Madison, when you wrote to Congress that Black people should count as 3/5 of a person, how long did you have to look at your slaves to figure out the math? Was it easy to chop them up? Did you think they'd be happy being more than just half human? James Monroe, when you proposed sending slaves back to Africa, did Black bodies feel like rented tools? When you branded them, did the scar on their chest include an expiration date? When you named the country Liberia, were you trying to be ironic? Does this really count as liberation? Andrew Jackson, was the Trail of Tears not enough for you? Was killing Cherokee, Choctaw, Creek, Seminoles not enough to quench your imperialism? How many brown bodies do you have to bulldoze before you can call it progress, Mr. Washington, Jefferson, Madison, Monroe, Jackson, when you put your hand on the Bible and swore to protect this country? Let's be honest in who you were talking about. When the first Independence Day fireworks set the sky aflame, don't forget where we were watching from. So when you remember Jefferson's genius, don't forget the slaves who built the bookshelves in his library. When you remember Jackson's victories in war, don't forget what he was fighting to preserve. When you sing that this country was founded on freedom, don't forget the duet of shackles dragging against the ground my entire life. I have been taught how perfect this country was, but no one ever told me about the pages torn out of my textbooks, how Black and brown bodies have been bludgeoned for 3 centuries and find no place in the curriculum. Oppression doesn't disappear just because you decided not to teach us that chapter. If you only hear one side of the story, at some point you have to question who the writer is.
Take a minute to think, then share your thoughts. Take a minute to think, then share your thoughts.
Powerful words. Videos like these should be shown in classrooms. Taking U.S. history this past year, it really is sad that our education on Native American and African American experiences are limited to 1 to 2 chapters. Very well said. Makes the audience question censorship in the American education system. This was extremely powerful. This video showed how flawed of a society we live in, where the white society before us have been committing wrongdoings and rightfully passing them under the rug because they could abuse their power. Our curriculum is a testimony of how biased it was developed. I agree. This was powerful and makes so much sense. All of us need to be aware of what slaves experienced and must vow to never permit that to happen again. What can we do today? Be more mindful of this past history and resolve to make changes so that everyone has equal rights and opportunities. We have to continue to challenge what we are taught. Question everything. It is very true that America was built on the back of Black people. That's why it's upsetting to see monuments and schools named after white leaders when the Black people that built up this country are forgotten and not even taught about.
Thank you everyone for sharing your thoughts. It seems that many of you resonated with Dr. Smith's poem. So now that we've gone over some history on FCPS, let's recap. We've had two schools named after Confederate soldiers, both now renamed, one after segregationist superintendent, and one named after a president who spoke of equality but supported slavery. Now, some of you attend these high schools. How does this make you feel? Feel free to share your thoughts in the chat.
Everyone is typing their thoughts. We also have a comment from one of the previous slides. It is so okay for us to express our dislike and discomfort. I really feel that the younger the students will be able to act on so much better information than we were taught and what was left out.
Thank you for sharing. We'll dive deeper during the discussion.
I feel disgusted knowing that FCPS is allowing these high school names up. I attend Justice and the advertisements are only in English, which means it only caters to those who speak English. A great number of students do not speak English, so they will not be able to attend these clubs or sport meetings.
Thank you for sharing, everyone. It's clear that within Fairfax County alone, there are a lot of historical events and decisions that affect us today. Now, we're going to look at Virginia and the US as a whole and what's been going on recently. First, let's talk about the Redskins. For over a decade now, the home team's name has stirred argument amongst fans. The term Redskins is argued upon whether it's honoring or degrading Native Americans. So let's quickly skim some history on the team. In 1933, the Boston Braves became the Redskins to avoid confusion. In 1937, the team moved to DC, and in 1971, there was a huge controversy over the team's name. In 1992, thousands protested at Super Bowl XXVI, and a lawsuit is filed. In 2000, they lose the lawsuit, and the team gets to keep their name. In 2013, soon after a Native American symposium where the team was asked to consider changing their name, the owner said, "We will never change the name. It's that simple. Never. You can use caps." Fast forward to 2020. In June, several corporations' investors requested that they end their relationship with the team unless they change their name. On July 3rd, the team announced that the name will be under review, and on July 13th, the team formally retired the Redskins' name. These patterns of injustice continue to repeat on several levels. Here are some statistics from a research article done in 2019 by a scientific journal. African American males are more at risk than any other group to be killed by police, then Native Americans, followed by Latinx. So now let's talk about some current events across the country, starting with George Floyd's murder. Floyd was killed by Minneapolis police officers. He was arrested after a store employee called the police saying that Mr. Floyd bought cigarettes with a fake $20 bill. Less than 20 minutes after the first police car showed up, George Floyd was pinned to the ground with a knee to his neck. He showed no signs of still being alive. 8 minutes and 46 seconds was the original estimate for how long Floyd had a knee to his neck. While his death became a worldwide symbol for protesters, it's one of many examples of police brutality against minorities. Floyd's death highlights the racial injustices that tend to be dismissed in America. Okay, so let's do a quick activity. When you see a name you recognize, type it in the chat. If you can, also mention what happened. If you need to search any name up, please do and share what you learn. I'll start. Natasha McKenna was having a schizophrenic episode when she was tased. She died in jail and spent 5 days on life support before being removed. She was a local, a Woodson alum. Lydia will read out some of your comments as you share. The link to this image and some information on the victims is in the chat.
While people are sharing the names and the stories from the screen, I'll read some of the previous comments. We are obliged to teach more about the plight of slaves and the injustices done to them. I suspect that when these schools were named after Confederate generals and soldiers, there wasn't enough research done. I think it's clear to see that the team changed their name only when they were financially accountable. I agree, it was only with the threat of the loss of financial backing that caused the name change.
Thank you for sharing.
And now for the names. Eric Garner was put into a chokehold until his last words were, "I can't breathe." He was killed for selling cigarettes. Eric Garner was asphyxiated in New York by police officers. Eric Garner. He was put into a similar position as George Floyd and pleaded for mercy and stated, "I can't breathe." Janet Wilson, shot by Dearborn police while she was unarmed. The officers opened fire and shot her multiple times. Breonna Taylor was murdered in her own home. If you're not safe in your own home, then there's fear everywhere. The police conducted a no-knock search warrant. Sandra Bland was found hanged in a jail cell after being arrested for a traffic stop. Michael Brown, unarmed teenager killed by the police. Tamir Rice was holding a toy gun and was shot by a police officer. The police officer shot him after immediately arriving on the scene. Dominique Clayton was killed in her home while she slept by a police officer. Troy Robinson was shocked by a taser while standing on a wall. He fell and broke his neck. Alonzo Smith died in custody of private security guards in an apartment complex. And Philando Castillo was fatally shot during a traffic stop. You can move on now, Amanda.
All right. Thank you for sharing. I wanted to share this article with you all because it provides a visual for racial injustices in American history and still today, with Floyd as a symbol for the violence. I'm briefly going to mention some historical events from this article. Ahmaud Arbery. On February 23rd, 2020, Arbery was killed by two white men in his South Georgia neighborhood. His killers were arrested due to public outcry 2 months later. Breonna Taylor was shot and killed in her home in Louisville by police officers on March 13, 2020. A judge signed a no-knock warrant, which allowed the police to enter without warning or identifying themselves. There's an investigation currently underway. No one has been arrested. Next, Ayanna Stanley Jones. She was 7 years old when she was shot and killed by the Detroit Police Department in her own home in 2010. All charges against the officer were dropped. Rodney King was beaten by Los Angeles police officers in 1991. The officers were tried in court, but were all cleared of charges. Medgar Evers was assassinated in 1963 by a member of the KKK. His killer was convicted 31 years later. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated in 1968. His killer was sentenced to 99 years in prison. However, King's family members do not believe that his true killer has been found yet. Malcolm X was assassinated in 1965. Three members of the Nation of Islam were convicted for his murder. Emmett Till was lynched in 1955 in Mississippi after he was accused of harassing Carol Bryant, a white woman. Till was violently beaten, shot in the head, tied to a metal fan, then shoved in the Tallahatchie River. When his corpse was found 3 days later, he was too disfigured to recognize. Till was identified by a ring he was wearing. In 67 minutes, an all-white, all-male jury would go on to rule that none of Emmett Till's killers were guilty. And 60 years later, before she died, Bryant admitted that he did not touch, threaten, or harass her. Emmett Till was 14 years old. The Tulsa Race Massacre. Between May 31st and June 1st of 1921, mobs attacked Black residents in the Greenwood District located in Oklahoma, a wealthy community that was nicknamed the Black Wall Street. Hundreds were hospitalized and killed. Thousands of homes and businesses were burned or destroyed. In 2000, a commission formed by Oklahoma State suggested that $33 million in restorations be given to the victims and their descendants. No such legislation was ever passed. Throughout history, while millions of slaves were given names by their owners, many were unnamed and their unmarked graves lie across the US. Brutality against minorities isn't uncommon or new. It's just changed over time. So now we'll be moving on to the discussion portion. Let me give you a moment to share your thoughts first.
We have a comment. Truly heartbreaking. Too many names were listed and the system fails to punish the guilty. All of this is horrifying and never justifiable. We must, people of all races, figure out a way to come together and right these wrongs. We can't possibly dismiss all of these heartbreaking stories. Now what? We all have to work for a better tomorrow to ensure that no other Black man or woman experiences these horrific events. There could be all the evidence in the world that could get the guilty convicted, and it never happens. So infuriating. Learning about Emmett Till just makes me worried that my brother, a 14-year-old Black boy, is at risk of being racially profiled. It is upsetting to see that these innocent African Americans were put through such traumas.
Thank you, everyone, for sharing your thoughts. We'll dive deeper during the discussion. Before we move on to the discussion, let's go over some norms. We acknowledge that
we can share our thoughts freely, we can disagree with others, and we can speak from different viewpoints.
We agree to
respect everyone's opinions, reserve judgment, and let people finish their truth before speaking.
Does everyone agree with these norms? Thank you for the agreement. I am now going to introduce today's guest speaker, Ms. Abrar Omish. Ms. Omish is one of three at-large members on the Fairfax County School Board, representing over 1 million residents. She attended Yale University, where she received a double bachelor's degree with honors and is now attending Georgetown University. Additionally, she's an FCPS alumni. Ms. Omish went to Robinson Secondary School, where she got her IB diploma. She also co-founded GIVE, a youth-led, youth-run, nonprofit organization that has been providing to thousands of youth across Northern Virginia, especially those who are underprivileged, with free tutoring and mentorship services in 20 locations for the past 10 years. And lastly, she worked in the FCPS Office of the Superintendent. Thank you for joining us today. Could you share a bit about yourself?
Absolutely. Thank you for having me. And thank you for starting these really important conversations. I hope everyone's been engaged and learned quite a bit today. A little bit about myself. You know, you touched on the bio. Having been a product of this community certainly was no stranger to disparity that exists right here at home. And being aware that I actually used to live in an area in Falls Church, in a different area in the county. And my dad ended up moving us to this area, Mantua, because of some of the socioeconomic disparities that remain a part of our community, right? So that was something that, you know, as I grew up, shaped my thinking and has led me to get involved in different ways that we'll talk more about the next session. So be sure to sign up as a teaser. But I'll leave it at that, and I'll certainly share more as we move along with the questions.
Thank you for sharing. Now, we'll be doing a brief interview before opening up the discussion to the audience. So, the first question, would you please go more in depth about specific incidents or events that inspired you to become a part of the Fairfax County School Board?
Absolutely. Thank you, Amanda. So, you know, as I was growing up in this community, I obviously look different, right? I grew up in Fairfax, so I've been here my whole life, my aunts and uncles, my cousins, my dad even grew up here. But there was always a sense of some level of difference, right? So as I grew up in the mosque, for example, and went there, we always knew, especially post 9/11, that the FBI was there. And the FBI, to this day, we joke about this, right? It's normal to see young Muslims in their talking. Let's say, you know, there's a news event or something and something terrorism comes up, whatever. There's always the running joke where we say, oh, to the FBI listening, or, you know, to the NSA, we're not plotting anything. It's become such a part of an internalized understanding. And in addition to that, because of the intersectionality of the Muslim community, which we'll talk about the next time, but there are many people who interface with law enforcement differently, right? I saw people unjustly arrested for things or even detained. To this day, people under terrorism charges that have no grounding. So growing up and not in that context always led me to question number one theme of what I want to share today is power. who gets to hold power, who gets to make decisions over us, and why do they have power? Like what entitled them to that relative to everyone else, right? So we all have a story. We all have some kind of experience. For me, that was certainly marginalization. Walking into a store, seeing how people would treat my mom, whose English wasn't as good as mine, right? So, and of course, seeing how my friends throughout high school were experiencing things like that as well. Whether it was, you know, a student who was treated differently for their disability, whether it was my Black friend who was called certain names, right? I mean, these are things that you all know exist in our schools and were a part of my experience. So they certainly inspired me again to question power, to think about what power means, and then to believe in the importance of wielding some of that power myself to make decisions that are good for our communities.
Definitely, and thank you for sharing that powerful anecdote. So the next question is going to be a little bigger and relating to Fairfax County, but on June 5th, of 2020, Dr. Brabant stated that, and I quote, racism and hate have no place in FCPS. Do you think that Fairfax County Public Schools have issues with racism?
Absolutely. I touched on briefly how I experienced this when I was a student, and how I saw this in the ways my peers engaged with one another and their experiences, even sometimes with staff and administration. Actually, now that I remember, one of the stories was we were just asking my principal, who was a nice bubbly guy, I mean he was well-meaning in every other way, but as we walk into his office to ask for a prayer space, I had two of my friends who were also Muslim women, and he just out of nowhere just goes, hey, it's the Burqa clan. And this was our principal, you know, and I mean, so many things wrong with that. I won't unpack right now, but to have experienced that and for that to have been normal, and that's just one example of a small tidbit of what many students experience. That brings me to the theme of implicit bias, right? That's where we have to start questioning ourselves, that I have threads of racism and bias in myself. We all do, and that all is a function of the environment around us, right? So most, you know, teachers, admin are well-meaning. Nobody really wants to be intentionally racist for the most part. There are certainly those people too. But when we start to check our own privilege, right? So that's another theme here, where someone comes from a particular background. They were lucky to have certain advantages maybe in the circumstances they were born into, right? Whether they're wealthier, whether they're they happen to fall into a race or religion or an orientation or an ability status that's more accepted by the majority, right? So their experience is going to be easier in that way. So that's what I see within FCPS, right? We have lots of implicit bias. We have folks who don't always have a strong understanding of their own privilege and how that introduces certain biases or ways of engaging in the community and in our schools. So I'm mindful of time. I can talk about this forever, but those are some themes that I want us to think about when we do, you know, think of our stories within FCPS and really, I mean, name it for what it is, because it does exist and it's everywhere and it's very common, even if people are well-meaning.
Definitely, and thank you for sharing your truth. So now we're going to open the discussion up to everyone. So the recording will now be turned off. Thank you all for joining us today and sharing your thoughts. A special thank you to Lydia and Ms. Edwards for running everything behind the scenes. And before we close off, I'm briefly going to go over what's next for Beyond 1619 and resources you can use to learn more. So first up, there will be Beyond 1619 Part 2. Make sure you're signed up for the second part. It'll be this Wednesday, August 12th from 1 p.m. to 2:30 p.m. If you're registered for both parts and attend both parts, you'll receive a certificate. And the link to the registration will be in the chat if you haven't already signed up. So we went over a lot of information today, but it's just the tip of the iceberg. Ms. Edwards has kindly compiled resources that you can access on the Fairfax County Library page. The link to this will be in the chat. And I have also created a document with links to all the information that I have used and movie recommendations. Those links will also be placed in the chat. On Wednesday, we'll be talking about social media and taking action. Before we end this seminar, take a few minutes to fill out this 5-question survey using the QR code or the link in the chat.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
Thank you all for joining us. You can scan this QR code if you'd like to connect on LinkedIn with Ms. Omish and I. Share the seminar online using the hashtag 1619FCPS. We hope to see you on Wednesday. Take care, everyone.